It might be the case that I'll be just humming around like dum 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 dum, and have all the kind of images from tigers and daffodils in my mind. So apologies for that. I don't know where the person who did it to me, but well, she left the office. Anyway, so great. So I guess my title in Norwegian, I don't know the Norwegian part, but at least the thing I sent in was like Taboo or About Time, the role of banks to crowdfunding. So I hope you like this topic. If not, just let me know in the meantime, because then may can change my slides. If it works, some way or the other. One second. So I hope to give you some inspiration and maybe some insights in how crowdfunding or crowd donating or even how banks work. But just to be sure, I'm a banker, and so it might be the case that you have a kind of feeling about bankers, I'm not sure. So the things I say at least are from a banking perspective. So you have to find your own ways and own methods in how to translate it to yourself. I'll do my best in the end to give you some insights on how what creative cities like Oslo can focus on, or like Berlin or other cities, but so just to let you know. Like was said before, I'm part of ABN AMRO. ABN AMRO used to be a large bank in the Netherlands. We were the biggest takeover in the financial industry. And then after that financial crisis took off, Royal Bank of Scotland got nationalized, Fortis Bank got nationalized, so I'm also a state employee. But it's an old bank, and I'm responsible for the direct incubator that's technically called corporate venturing, or incubation. And it's where brilliant ideas turn into ventures. So things we do, we've been asked to look into new markets. New markets, new ways of working, new kinds of, new news. And we do that by focusing on intellectual capital, not just on pouring money in, because there's no money left in the world, but by looking into how we can make clever and new kinds of ways. And so we believe to create a kind of next generation or new kind of banks. To give you some examples of things we have done, the companies we set up, and things we've been busy with, this sounds a bit like financial, like pensions. There's a whole thing going on from defined benefit to defined contribution. So we're busy in that market. We've been trading, having platforms for trading emotional scarcity. It's kind of different topic. We had some ventures around marketplaces, also a tool that controls stress whilst doing transactions on the internet. We believe that's also a next generation bank to help you out with your intuition. Been busy in the art world. We had some art ventures, trading art. We also have an institute for brilliant failures. To at least, it's pretty filled up with our own examples, but it's a kind of way to tell people that failing is okay. Because success is probably, that's the end result of failing a lot of times before. So we spent some time and especially invested some money in setting up an institute for that. And I'll be telling you a bit about crowdfunding. So these are just some of the examples we've been doing in the last couple of 5 years. And so basically what we do, we try to facilitate people and try to leverage and to connect and to tie into the new world as an old bank. And that's all those things are more or less connected to taboos. Because taboos, at least from a social perspective, taboos are always very interesting. And also from a banking or a business perspective, because taboos is always the place when it's between the white and black, the gray zone, and from a business perspective, there's a lot of margin over there, because nobody knows exactly what it's like, nobody knows, apart from the typical areas like sex, and I won't talk sex and drugs. I'm from Amsterdam, but I won't tell you about it, not too much, unless you really insist. But it's interesting to focus on, to look at taboos in any society, in any business. So where can we not talk about? And crowdfunding is one of them. Because these kind of new markets in which a lot of organizations have new roles. And we have to define new worlds. And that can be the breaking through of a taboo. To say, okay, let's focus on that market. Let's jump into that market and see whatever works. I'm from a bank, and banks are typical. They are not used to innovate in the sense that we are We are being paid to look after your money. There were some times, like recent times, that we didn't completely understand the meaning of that, but basically we have to look after your money and we have to calculate the risk and to have to mitigate the risk for your benefit, more or less. So for banking perspective, taboos are irrelevant because we're not like casino bank, rien ne va plus, black and white, black and white, black and white, black and red. So banks don't work like that. And taboos are always connected to more complex systems. So when you look into a lot of innovations in the financial industry, sorry, I'm standing in the line. That's my colleague over there. No. So a lot of companies like banks, financial institutions, more or less have gotten into fallen into sleep. They thought, okay, internet, it will vanish. Or we are the ones, the most important, the gladiators of the universe. And so that's difficult for a bank. So looking into new trends, it's important for banks to understand what kind of business models rely on that. I will dive a bit into the kind of what kind of business model is underneath a crowdfunding initiative or like the things we do. But first, let me try to explain what crowdfunding is all about. Is anybody of you not familiar with crowdfunding? Okay, good. So my next 20 slides are at least useful for you. Because there's a lot of buzz, at least in the financial market, creative sectors, cultural sectors, about crowdfunding as the panacea for a lot of solutions of government going back and not having the funds anymore. And so it's crowds online, wiki, blah, blah, blah. It's all very interesting. So basically, what crowdfunding is about is a two-way stream. One is projects, business, ideas, products, whatsoever, services that need funding. And on the other hand, people that want to reach a certain need and want to invest. And there's a platform for that, like with small animals and so on, where they can meet and achieve the goals. And a lot of trends in the market connect to that, from wisdom of crowds to open innovation to more do-it-yourself kind of structures. All these kind of, a lot of trends connect to that, and most of them are connected to a kind of a connected, internet-connected world. And that's true, because crowdfunding is just that's a subset of crowdsourcing. And crowdsourcing all the things, let's buy it, let's do it together, everything you can do online, and that's already a subset of all the social networks. Probably you're familiar with the Hives, the Facebooks, the LinkedIns, all these kind of social networks. They bring together people, and crowdsourcing is about knowledge sharing and doing things together, and funding is really about the money. So what we've seen in the market up to now is that crowdfunding is mostly about passion. To give you some examples, like Mr. Obama once did, so he won from his competitor, not by the public funds, but by the private funds, the private donators with whom he helped raising money. And you have a lot of other examples in the market, from music industry, sell a band, 10 pages, on movies, this for t-shirts if you like, and for the men out there, and maybe some women, you can also crowdfund a football team, and even beer. I was especially fond of that. And on the social part, you have also a lot of examples like Kiva, MyC4, and these are more donations. And you might even say that European bailouts for Greece, Ireland, and whatever country is also kind of crowdfunding, crowdfunded by us European citizens. These are just some of the examples, like 300 platforms worldwide operating now. So it's, and you can say they're like in startups, supporting projects, microcredits, and donations. We believe crowdfunding is also about business, because these are nice ones, but it will accelerate part of the economic growth, but it will not really start off new economic growth. So there's also an opportunity for crowdfunding to focus more on entrepreneurial activities. So more or less the principles are the same. So it's still a group of investors brought together, and still a platform that facilitates it. But it also adds to that legal, fiscal, financial structures. And that all is more and more relevant these days due to, of course, the crisis. That banks have gotten reluctant to do so, that the crisis also kills a lot of big, old, boring companies, and it gives a lot of room for new startups. And also people would want to invest more in new kinds of products. They want to diversify from an investment perspective. They want to diversify not only in shares, but more local, close by. And that's what you have seen from on banking analysis, is that people get fed up with like companies in BP to invest. You have your pension in that, or your shares, or part of your house mortgage in that. And that you cannot control these kind of companies. And that they, in the end, I'm not talking about BP, but just to take it as an example, that they do harm to the public and may interfere with your public and your private feelings on how the world should look like. So we have seen a rise of people's getting more like activated to follow their own dreams. And looking at that from an entrepreneurial perspective, there is an equity gap. And what we see there, like in a financial model, you have the three F's on the friends, families, and fools, as we say. So if you're an entrepreneur, or to be entrepreneur, if you cannot raise like 35,000 euros yourself, and I guess you have to do your own math in regarding for the NOx, but then so probably you're not the entrepreneur people anticipate you to be. So most of the time, banks, families, and other people you meet on the street, let's say fools, they will help you out getting your first kind of money if you have a business model to that. At one point in time, normally at the bridge is around 150,000 euros, you have a new kind of system with informal investors, venture capitalists, private equity, share listings, blah, 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 blah. So there's a whole kind of stream after that, but there's something in the middle that's called an equity gap. What we've seen is that a lot of entrepreneurs who so they can get the first can raise the first kind of capital, and afterwards they find it difficult to connect to that. And what we've seen it not only in the Netherlands but also in a European perspective, because there is an equity gap, especially in Europe. In America it's a bit better, but for Europe it's there is something. So it's you nurture your babies and you treat the elderly well, but for the adolescents it's difficult. So it not only accounts for probably for the financial system, but also for the public system. So there's a gap into that. And what the crowdfunding platforms, which where there's room for maneuver, is that to look into those three ones which can facilitate or accelerate it. There's, for the one hand, entrepreneurs. They need money to grow. They need money to sustain. And these kind of platforms, they build kind of lower transaction costs because it's more online, less paperwork. On the other hand, for the investors, it's easier and more fun to do so online as well. They don't have to go to a bank again. They can just do click and search for the thing online. And last, the web accelerates everything. All the peer-to-peer, all the social media, it makes it far more easy to check out whether a company is a real company, whether it's not fraudulent. And that's really one of the biggest challenges in the industry, or in the internet, is how to bring trust again to the sector, to the internet. As a man, I get a lot of spam email from all kinds of interesting offers. So internet is being spammed with, filled with corruption and filth, so to say, and how to bring trust again to platforms like this. But to dive into that, so we can say there are three phases in the crowdfunding, pre-crowdfunding and post-crowdfunding. So the pre-crowdfunding phase would be the selection of the entrepreneurs with these platforms you have. So that you have no obvious issues with fraudulent companies on the platform. Because you as an investor, as a possible investor, you want to invest in good stuff. You don't want to invest in frauds. Some of you may know Kickstarter. Who knows Kickstarter? You know Kickstarter, some of you know. So the Kickstarter is now a big thing going on in the US, but it used to be that out of the first 10 investments, 7 were fraudulent. So there are a lot of difficulties in the beginning because people invested money in that, and after a year it turned out that 7 companies that went to the Bahamas did other stuff with the money instead of using it to grow a business. after the so the selection of the companies, you have the kind of crowdfunding phase, and I won't bore you too much with that, but it's kind of business proposal presentations, the matching of entrepreneurs and investors, online contracting and investments. After that, after that's done, takes some time sometimes, they have the really execution. That's the paper trail, accountancy networks, and also to building and connecting to the community. So what we have seen is that investors like these, like these kind of platforms, because they look for alternative ways. They want to be more involved into government and to the government of the companies, and they feel more personally attached to that. It is also, from a government perspective, it's also useful, and especially from financial government, and I guess in Norway it's the same as in any other European company. I guess 3 out of the 5 headlines in any newspaper these days is about financial systems, how to make it more democratic, how to make it more sustainable, and how to survive as a whole as European Commission. And it's all more or less connected to these kind of principles. Crowdfunding is not the answer, but it's a part of the solution. So crowdfunding looks promising, but there are some issues, and I'd just like to highlight some of them before ending with some advice I would have to any creative city like Oslo to dive into this, because there are some risks attached to that. So first of all, what we have seen in the market is that people online behave differently than offline. And at least banks don't understand that, and I know most governments don't understand that as well. Another one is that most of those models, like online, are for free. Freemium models you have, where you pay, but it's for software. But you don't expect to pay for Facebook. Nobody would understand if you have a social network nowadays, that you have to pay for that as a user. It will be probably in the near future, but for now it's impossible. So most of those models are free, but somebody needs to make money. So it's difficult to see where the business model is. Where are the margins? Another one is that for some reason not a lot of people these days have the money because they're more focused on maintaining their job. I know in Norway the unemployment is very low, but I know for other cities and other companies, countries, employment rate is rising, and so it's very difficult to do anything with crowdfunding over there. And last but not least, and that's again the transparency thing, and so how to make, how to have these kind of transparent models, because everything you do online can be tracked and traced, and can be, you can check out any actions of a person or an investor or a company for like 5 to 10 years. So that's difficult. So a lot of those platforms will probably make mistakes, and so we don't know which model will survive. We don't know. So one of my conclusions to you, I would like to give, crowdfunding is an interesting one, but it's really in its baby phase, or in the adolescent phase. So to dive into that, for example, crowdfunding. So the crowd part is not even, nobody agrees upon crowds. Is it peer-to-peer, is it on groups, or is it in crowds, like in crowds, or is it what people say these days, tribes? Tribes really like with the chief and totem, other things, but you can use it in a kind of social context. Tribes really like families. So there's a lot of debate on that, and internet in general, but also on crowdfunding. So what are we talking about? Do we want to feel connected to make it work, or is it just like everybody's online, so all my friends from Facebook are mine, also my closer friends? It's not, but that's one of the things when you look into crowdfunding, you want to retrieve information about crowdfunding, there's no real solution, there's no alignment on the wording. The same is for the funding part. Sorry for the piece of art. So funding in financial terms or in banking terms, it most of the time means loans or shares or certificates of shares. But the examples I've shown you, from Kiva to MyC4 to some other examples, are mostly not about funding, they're about donations or in-kind rewards, which is all very nice, but it's totally different especially from a legal perspective, and so from a government perspective, but it's about donations, giving away, or expecting something in return. You really have to do then, you have to follow rules of law. And also from the investor point of view, like I said, some platforms are really to feel, make you feel happy, and other ones are really like get rich or die trying, to quote a famous poet. It is really about getting to, so what's the kind of reward you have for your company? So we're trying to look into kind of ecosystem to make it work, because just a platform itself doesn't work, will not work. Like, I'll just give you some of the slides we've been doing, we've been working on for the last couple of years. This one of a Dutch perspective, but also have some European insights for you. So as a bank, we decided it's good to invest these kind of things. Because we as a bank, it's easy for us to sit back and relax and say, okay, what will happen? We don't know. Let's see, and it will never work. And we decided to focus because we had seen this gap before from banking perspective, and we know there are some issues with that. So we decided to investigate how we could solve or at least facilitate the equity gap. So we're setting up also a crowdfunding platform focusing up between 35 and 150,000 euros. So not the friends, family, and fools, because we believe there are more efficient systems for that, but like the middle. It's also to participate and to get rewards for that for a minimum of 50 euros, and to focus on social environmental impact. So good companies. And what we believe and what we offer to the entrepreneurs and to the investors, first of all, on the entrepreneurial side, it's the expansion, the startup capital. Second, an online community of ambassadors. That you can really connect the ambassadors, that it takes away a lot of other marketing or media or communication hassle, but you can do it via one platform. And also a professional online tool with all the legal and fiscal issues you might need. Because that's also running a business, apart from making money, it's also about dealing with the red tape and dealing with your fiscal procedures. On the other hand, we offer the investors return on investment and also the products. Because we believe return on involvement is equally important. It's not only about the money, we believe in our model at least, people are more interested in giving meaning to society and making money, so return on investment and on return on involvement. And so it's also the social investment. So that's what we see and that's what we believe in, impact investing, making the bridge between money and meaning, that's the way to go, at least for our platform, which is also called impact investing. And so getting back to the taboo thing, this really scares the hell out of our managing boards, because they don't like that. And other banks don't like that as well. They say, why are you in heaven's name investigating this? Because when you do this as a bank, it will be legal, it will be official. So why do this? We really believe it's an extension of the current business. It will not replace the loaning structure, donation structure, or other kind of things. It really extend it. It will really help out other sectors to accelerate. And it will make banks a more important role in society. And the role will change. It will not be by the giants of the future or Battlestar Galactica kind of thing, but it will be much more facilitating. And it will also be not making the money, but creating an infrastructure, which is plain and which is boring for some people, but it's good that somebody takes care of the roads. That somebody, and then you have all kind of fancy car makers and bicycles and what's the transportation, and we just have to focus on the infrastructure. And with that, we can add trust to the system, because trust is really what's lacking these days, interpersonal trust, but also intercompany trust. And last but not least, from our role as a bank, we can closely connect, which we do also in the Netherlands and the European basis, connect to the policymakers, different industries, and to, in the end, also financial counterparts. Because that's what the ecosystem should be about. To address some of the issues that are still lacking, apart from the internet part, there's a lot of things, and it's just a small list. It's fair pricing, fair treatment, all fair. Also preventing money laundering. As a European Commission, it's and a European Union, it's really important to have all the there's not too much corruption in the system. And as a bank, you more or less you're the first point of contact for entering the financial system. And when you're in the system, everything will be white. And was for example one of the problems within Greece. It doesn't function over there, and that half, or at least I think it's a quarter of the economy, is on the black market. So people don't pay taxes, and that's why one of the reasons why Greece, why we all are paying for Greece. Of course, I love the Sitaki, but it's it shouldn't work like that. So we don't have to pay for them. So for the Netherlands, we are getting traction. For the Netherlands, it's a small company, it's a small country like Norway. So we are fully aligned with our Dutch National Bank and with our financial authorities. So we have all the approvals to do this. And actually, it's a bit strange, but we're the first in the world really to have these kind of official exemptions. In the European Commission, European Union, it's really modest. They're looking into that, they're saying, okay, Lisbon agenda is really important. Crowdfunding should be one of the ways forward. But it's still much more focused on local regions, local cities, not any kind of harmonization. Yeah, so most people have the same kind of currency, but it's all totally different. So if you would like to invest, for example, in Berlin, that's very difficult. We have totally different fiscal, legal, and all the other official stuff. So before wrapping it up, so for creative cities, if I would be the mayor, for example, of Oslo, of Helsinki or whatsoever. So what should I do? I believe there are several initiatives which might be interesting for you if I would be the mayor. First of all, realizing that it is close by, but never mix a clear view with a short distance. It is close by, but it will take you time to learn and to see whatever model works, because you have to develop the ecosystem. First of them, I would believe in facilitating and co-creating any kind of infrastructure. I took this picture yesterday. I guess here are shared bikes like you have in Paris or London. I don't know whether anybody is using them, but at least I know that these are one of the things which public loves as well. Public US, also citizens, for example, would care to invest in, because it's a part of the city. It's part of, if you attach to that. So I could really say this would be an interesting one to look into that. To say, I as a mayor of Oslo, I have to invest in these kind of facilities, which are very useful for the public, for the citizens. Let's do this together. And let's ask the citizens to pay for this as well, to invest in this as well. Another one, obvious, but just is of course the creative industry, culture industry, creative industry. Not by pouring money into it, because it doesn't make sense anymore, but by co-creating as well and saying, okay, let's do this together. We may pay for something, and you as a public can pay for it as well. So in the culture and creative sector, it will work, especially when it's more entrepreneurial, because otherwise it's just replacing any subsidy parts. A third one would be in any kind of social impact investing, combining meaning and business. So focusing on things that businesses that, for example, share part of the profits for the greater good. Anything which is playful, which you might like to do. Bless you. So by helping out, that crowdfunding helps also by creating kind of funny atmosphere in your environment. And last but not least, I would focus, especially for the women over here, in anything that connects to your DNA. So it connects what's really good of Norway. And I'm an outsider, so I don't have that the feeling of that. But I guess when you focus on the things Norway is good at, and then make that, people would like to be part of things they're good at, or part of the future. So I would, if I would be Norway or also, I would really focus on, in this case, the husbands, but maybe in other ways, the DNA. And just for Nicholas, I would also say, because he gave such a nice presentation on Oslo, some nice comments on Oslo. I could really imagine a kind of help Berlin kind of crowdfunds to lower the debt. It's a kind of development aid. Anyway, so probably, and I can imagine 10 other things. I just wanted to highlight some of them to you. Some of them will fail. I'm aware of that. But you have to do this. So you have to experience what will work and what not will not work. That will, especially for governments, that will be exciting, knowing that banks, which are even more risk averse than governments, at least some countries, so it will be interesting, and probably you will fail, but that's okay because we have a platform for that. But in the end, then the future will belong to you. And you'll at least have fun during the ride. That's my presentation.
Thank you very much. This is, I think this the theme of crowdfunding, the issue of crowdfunding is quite new in Norway. To many of us, it has been maybe the first meeting, the first time we kind of scratched the surface of that topic. And I think you have inspired us a lot to dig more into it. It's interesting to note, at least that's my come into my mind, that the needs you have forms your tools, and in Norway we have this the financial situation in our national economics, which probably is not driving us very much towards the the risk-averse methods and tools, but at least in this sector, in the cultural creative industry, the gap is there. The need for financing is there, and the tools that you have outlined to us is I'm quite confident will be very sharply and very thoroughly scrutinized in the times to come. But thank you very much. And I will allow also other comments, a couple, if there are questions, comments, please feel free.
Even questions about tigers or daffodils? I'll take them.
Okay. Then we will move on. Thank you very much.